see you here with us tonight. Let's bow our heads, ask God to bless in the service tonight. Dear Lord, we're grateful to be here in the house of God tonight. We're thankful, Father, for the great service you gave to us this morning. We're trusting you'll bless in this service tonight. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with me as we begin with hymn number 313, Sunlight, Sunlight, number 313. I wandered in the shades of night till Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love bid all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today, sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since my Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. Though clouds may gather in the sky and billows round me roll, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today, sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. While walking in the light of God, I sweet communion find. I press with holy vigor on and leave the world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today, sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. I cross the wide extended fields, I journey o'er the plain, and in the sunlight of his love I reap the golden grain. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today, sunlight, sunlight all along the way. I have had the sunlight of his love within. Take a verse or two and greet those around you. Continue singing with number 402, Oh to Be Like Thee. Once you find your seats, number 402, Oh to Be Like Thee. Oh to be like thee, bless. blessed Redeemer. This is my constant longing and prayer. Gladly I'll forfeit all lover's treasure, perfect likeness to wear. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, full of compassion, loving, forgiving, tender and kind, helping the helpless, cheering the fainting, seeking the wandering sinner to find. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart. Oh, to be like thee, lowly in spirit, harmless, patient and brave, meekly enduring cruel reproaches, others to save. Oh, to be like thee, oh, to be like thee, blessed Redeemer, pure as thou art. Come in thy sweetness, come in thy fullness, stamp thine own image deep on my heart.
Wonderful singing, you may be seated.
To have the Dr. Smeltz here with us tonight and his dear wife and grandson, and he's going to come just give us a word about missions and lead us in prayer for the offering tonight.
In 1966, I came home from Vietnam after two tours. I was lost. I was without Christ. I knew nothing about Christ. I'd been raised in a Catholic family. The only thing I knew was what the Catholics knew. I wandered and skirted around the country. In Miami, I ended up working in a nightclub as a head bouncer for the largest liquor chain in the state of Florida. In October of 1970, I met a young lady who invited me to go to church. I went to church. I had not been really into a Protestant church, but I went along with her to that church, and the late Dr. Ray Sadler was the speaker there, the evangelist that night. On a Monday night, I went, and I thought I was in the wrong crowd, and I really did think I was going to end up in a fight, because I looked around and saw all these men. They were acting kind of weird, and of course, back then, Vietnam veterans were not, they were not loved, and they were not respected, and so I thought, well, maybe I'm just going to get by the night. I spent that night, and I left and went back out, went to work that night back at the nightclub. I got good and drunk. The next day, that young lady called me. And she said, you want to go back to church tonight? And I thought to myself, twice going to church. Well, I went back the second night. She had told everybody about who I was and what I had done and the things that I was doing at the time. And I didn't realize that those men were beginning to pray for me, and they were beginning to lift me up before the Heavenly Father. And that night, I didn't actually listen to what the preacher said. I just was glad to get out of there. I left. The next day, she called again. She was very consistent. She called again and asked me if I wanted to go back on Wednesday night. I went back on Wednesday night. I was a little bit more open to hear the gospel. And I listened that night. And the Holy Spirit began to convict me about my condition, where I was. I was lost. I knew I was lost. I had no doubt in my mind that I was lost. Anyway, I went home that night. And Thursday morning, she called and she said, you need to come tonight, because he's going to speak on a subject you need to hear. I went there that night, and of course, Ray had also been in Vietnam. He was a pilot. He had been burnt. Most of his face had been burnt from a crash that he was in. And that night, he preached a message on hell. I'll never forget the illustration that he gave. He said when the airplanes would come in and drop napalm on the villages, you could hear the people screaming and crying aloud. And that night I went back to Vietnam all over again because I remember all the screaming. I remember the crying. I thought the only hell that I had ever known was Vietnam. But that night when the invitation was given, I ran. I didn't walk. I ran. I ran as fast as I could. And I got up before Dr. Sadler. And Dr. Sadler said, what do you come for, son? What are you up here? I said, I don't know what you have, but I surely do need it. And that night I went down by the altar and Dr. Sadler came down. He took the word of God. I didn't have any problem recognizing I was a sinner. I knew I was a sinner. I knew that I was bound for hell. And realizing that night how lost that I was, I cried out to a wonderful Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He reached down and he touched me that night, and he saved my wicked soul. Amen. That night I went back to that nightclub where I worked at, and I walked in. And some of the people said to me, what did you do tonight? I said, I got saved. And they said, saved from what? And the only thing that could come to my mind was saved from every one of you. I walked out of that place that night, never to return. From that night on, no one had to tell me that I had to stop drinking. I stopped. No one had to tell me my life had to change. It was changing immediately because Jesus had entered me. And I knew that night I was a child of God. Amen. Little did I know what God was going to do with me. I had no idea. 4 months later, I married that young woman. I'm married to her today. And she was the instrument that God used to bring me to church. She was the instrument that God used to get me saved. She was the instrument that God used. We'll be married 47 years in February. And we started our life in Christ. And Christ has been the center of our life, all of our married life. Mm-hmm. And I thank God for that. Our children have only known that their father has loved God. And even through all the things that we've gone through, they have seen how Mama and I have served God for all these years. I thank the Lord Jesus Christ for his salvation. If you're not saved tonight, let me tell you, my friends, tonight, he loves you. Mm-hmm. He loves you. Let us pray. Father, thank you, God, for loving me. Thank you for that awesome day in October of 1970 when you spoke to my heart and I realized without a doubt that God, that you loved me. For the first time I realized there was a love that was so much different than all the love that the world had to offer. It was a love that was deep. It was a love that was paid for by your blood. And oh God, I thank you for that night. And I pray tonight, God, if there's one here, oh God, if there's one here that has never really cried out to you, God, I pray tonight, through the power of the Word of God, through the Holy Spirit that speaks to their heart, I pray tonight, God, you would save that one that's closest to hell. Thank you for these that have come out tonight. Lord, have your way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
What's the name of that song? Number 511 on Jordan's Stormy Banks. You can keep your seats for this one tonight. Number 511.
On Jordan's stormy banks I stand and cast a wishful eye to Canaan's fair and happy land where my possessions lie. I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land. All o'er those wide extended plains shines one eternal day. There God the Son forever reigns and scatters night away. I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land. No chilling winds nor poisonous breath can reach that healthful shore. Sickness and sorrow, pain and death are felt and feared no more. I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land. When shall I reach that happy place and be forever blessed?
When shall I see
my Father's face and in His bosom rest? I am bound for the promised land. I am bound for the promised land. Oh, who will come and go with me? I am bound for the promised land.
Have you ever felt a Father's love as He holds you in His arms? And when you start to say, I'm sorry, He says you've done nothing wrong. Have you failed to meet the standards that you thought you should attain, only to hear Him call your name? You are loved beyond your failures. You are loved beyond your past. The hope that you've imagined is now reality at last. You are loved with no conditions. You are loved with no remorse. The scars of your forgiveness are engraved upon the Lord. You are loved.
Have you seen your life be torn apart by things you could not help, until you finally reach the point where you can only blame yourself? And have you laid your head to sleep and think that you're
nations. You are loved with no remorse. The scars of your forgiveness are engraved upon the Lord. You are loved. You are loved. You are loved.
Amen.
Amen. Well, just before the preaching, we're going to have the Patch the Pirate Club be dismissed. Going to go right out this door over here. Glad to have Dr. David Smeltz here with us, and his wife Susan been coming here for several weeks, and they actually have moved down into the Northport area and been coming to our church, and they like our church. He's a missionary evangelist and works in a number of countries, written many books. If you go out there in the foyer, you see all the number of the books that he's written out there. Some great reading material, some great helps for you. But we're glad to have these folks here with us tonight, and he's going to give us, are you going to show the video first?
Yeah.
Okay, he's going to show a video first of his ministry, and do you need to say something about that?
Yeah, or? I'll talk right through it.
Okay, and then he's going to preach to us tonight, but we're glad to have him here with us at Liberty Baptist Church. All that are glad to have him, say a hearty amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you, brother.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you. We're going to show you. I think we'll just do the one instead of two because of time. Let's do that first one, the welcome one, okay? All right. Yeah. Oh, that's the other one. Let's go there. Okay, cool. Let's hope it should be automatic. It's not? Click it. Okay, here it goes. We founded His Word of Truth Ministries in 1973. God called me into ministry. My pastor said to me, he said, Brother Dave, he said, you need to start preaching. And so I started preaching in 1973. And then I ended up going to Bible college. And I ended up at Liberty University in 1974 through 1978. These are the books that I have written. These are the cult books. I don't know why it's going so slow. We said a little while ago, we talked about this, that this thing, this is what the devil does, you know. Click it and see it. This is what he does. But we're going to do something different, okay? All right, because we're not going to play around with this. Kick that one out completely. And go to the other one. Just kick it out. Here's the one. This you'll enjoy this one. This is our mission trip that we did to Guatemala. We just got back. This is a medical missions trip. I hope you enjoy this.
Good morning, folks. We are in Santa Tomas, Guatemala. And what we are doing here is a dental medical missions team. And it has been fabulous. We've been here already for 2 days. I believe we have already seen 80 patients pass through this, and we've got some wonderful doctors with us, and I want to introduce them to you, and we've also got a tremendous nurse with us, and this fellow's got quite a history. He was in the military, and I just praise God for Robbie that Robbie's here, and Manala, she's over here, and so God is so good. This is Dr. Carville. He is out of Lynchburg, Virginia. He has his own practice. And he not only does dental work, but he also does facial reconstruction. He does so much, and we just praise God that he has taken the time to want to come and do this. Dr. Carville, can you just say a few words to the folks that are out here?
Well, you know, I think that there is a tremendous need here, and we're really happy to be a part of it, to be able to provide service and give back to a community that's less fortunate than ours.
Thank you, Dr. Carville. This is Dr. Binder. I met Joshua several months ago, and it just seems like God brought us together. And, of course, through Joshua, Dr. Carville came in. And Joshua has also a practice in Lynchburg, Virginia. And I have enjoyed. He did work on my teeth, so I can actually say he's not too bad. He did a wonderful job. The VA sent me to him, and I thank God for Joshua. Joshua, you've got a few words that you'd like to say?
Sure. Yeah, it was a great undertaking.
get us down here and get all the equipment here, but it's been a blessing to be able to help all the people, the wonderful people here that have come, and we're able to get them out of pain and where they have infection and decay and broken down teeth. And just being able to help, it's a blessing. So I've enjoyed every moment of it.
And I want to say that Dr. Binder and Dr. Carville, both of them, all of the supplies that I'll show you in a few minutes, everything that is here was provided by them. And we thank God for that. Now, I want to introduce you to the director of Care Link Ministries, Dr. Ron Maggard.
Hello, good morning.
Dr. Ron, what do you got to say today?
Well, it's another day, and what a blessing it is to be back out here. We appreciate so much the work of our doctors here. They are being a tremendous help and blessing to this community in Santo Tomas de Cantón, our neighborhood of San Juan Basá. And what a blessing it's been, and the people. I mean, every day we see all we can, and then they start signing up for the next day. And as you can see out the door, when we pulled up this morning, they were all standing around waiting for the possibility of having service. And we can only see so many, you know, every day, but we're trying to see every one of them that we can during this time. And so there's a tremendous opportunity here, and it's a tremendous outreach for our church and ministry, because these people can see and appreciate the work that we're trying to do and the blessing that we're trying to be here in this community. We're meeting with some ladies this morning who are introducing us to widows, and we've got other ladies who are bringing some at-risk children that need to be cared for. And so we're trying to do all of this in this facility. And a good anchor point is the medical and dental here. And so we're so appreciative for these guys being here this week helping us.
Thank you, Dr. Maggard. This is Ronnie.
So my job is I keep the doctors going. I just make sure the supplies are in order. The doctors, if they need them, I grab them and bring them to them. And I basically am just the do boy for the doctors that are making the impact on these people's lives.
Robbie came at the last minute. We didn't know he was coming, but God laid upon his heart to come, and he has been such a blessing, not only to us, but to the doctors. So let's look out here for a moment. Let's see all these wonderful people that have come. Look out here and look at these folks. They're all coming today for dental health, dental care. This is what it's all about, folks. This is the ministry at 100% where we're able to effectively touch the hearts of people, not only physically, but also spiritually. Many of these have heard the gospel of Jesus Christ and have come to Christ through the power of the Word of God. And we thank God for that. And I thank God for all of these folks. I hope that you will just really pray for us. Pray for us as we endeavor to do the work that God has called us to do. I thank you so much. Robbie, would you do me one favor? I want you to turn. I'm going to turn this camera around to you so you can get me, okay? All right. Folks, I thank you for listening to this little video. As you can see, it's an emotional thing. It really means something to me. As I look out at these people, I see them in their needs, spiritually, physically, and mentally. That's what God does. God brings spiritual help. He brings physical help. He helps the mentally weak. He helps the mentally strong. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here. We ask that you pray about us. This whole facility is a step of faith. We're asking God to be able to provide the finances for this facility. We've stepped up by faith. We have 6 months to raise $120,000 to buy this whole facility. It has to be done. And the only way it's going to get done is if God touches your heart and burdens you as he's burdened us to do the work that is here. Thank you so much for listening. And we'll put a little catch-all on the end of this where you can send your finances to through Catholic Ministries or through His Word of Truth International Ministries. We want to see this come about, and I know you will help us do it. I just know you will. God bless you, and thank you. for taking the time to listen to this video. God bless you.
I wish the other one would have been working for you to see the work that we're doing in Haiti, the work that we're doing in the Philippines, the work that we're doing in Vietnam, in Cambodia, and around the world. You know, we just do it. We just go and do it. We don't try to do anything, make any big deal out of it. We just go and do it. We partner with individuals. My wife, I have to give my wife a lot of credit. Susan, why don't you stand up a minute? Bless her heart. You know, a lot of times missionaries don't mention much about their wife, but my wife goes into the bush. She's been in the bush with me. She's been with the spiders and the bugs, and she's been with everything. I mean, she's been through it all. And I'm in Ukraine. She's been to Ukraine. She's been to Russia. She's gone with me wherever we go. And I praise God because she's my helpmate. She kind of keeps me straight while I'm there. And she makes sure that I eat right and makes sure that I do what I'm supposed to do. And I thank God for my wife. She's a big help to the ladies. My wife is also a deaf interpreter. And she works with the deaf. She worked with the deaf in the Philippines. She helped in training them. She led the first young lady to ever come to know Jesus Christ in Brazil, in the province of Rondônia, to Jesus Christ, a deaf girl. So, I mean, our ministry is kind of joint together. We work it all together. We don't try to make a big deal out of it. We're no big shots. We're just loving people that try to love God and do the best we can. I've never tried to be anything other than what I am, and that's just what I am. And what you see is what you get. And I praise God for that. Amen? I don't think there's any showmanship in the gospel. I don't like showmanship. I really don't. I think we're supposed to love one another. I want to talk to you a little bit about that in just a minute, about loving, because there's so much in loving and caring. I want you to turn us over. There we go. Got it there. Look at that. And I got my little clicker here on top of it. Now, I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm mentally challenged with these things. Anybody know what mentally challenged means? And sometimes I'll get to clicking, and I'll get to clicking the wrong way. And the next thing you know, I'm going backwards instead of going forwards. Amen? And so you all pray for me tonight that I'll click in the right direction. You know, your pastor, he's used to clicking. He just clicks, you know. For me, it's I do this all the time. I get a lot of churches, and they like PowerPoint. And more people today really want PowerPoint. And so I've developed most of what I have. All of our lessons that we do overseas and all the Bible lessons and everything are all on PowerPoint. Everything has been developed into PowerPoint. And I have it in one language. For instance, I'll have it in Russian over here, and then I'll have it in English over here. My translator's over here looking at the Russian side, and I'm looking at the English side, trying to stay up with him. He's trying to stay up with me. That's a real challenge, folks. And then when you have two translators, that is really a challenge. You've got one translator doing it in one language, another doing it in another language, and you're doing English. You really are challenged with that. You've got to remember where you left off at. And it's really something. You pray for us as we go, because we love to do that. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles tonight to the book of Galatians, would you please? The book of Galatians. Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians number 5, starting with verse number 13. Would you stand with me, please, in reverence to the reading of God's word? For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty only. Use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this. Thou, one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor. Appreciate the song, George, tonight. I think your wife, did you play too and sing? Amen. That song, I said, you know, God, that song is exactly what I'm going to be talking about, love. It's exactly, isn't it interesting how God brings things together? And then look at verse number 15. But if ye bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. This I say, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Father, help me tonight. I do need your help, Father. I can do nothing without you. I pray that the Spirit of God will take my mouth, the words that come forth out of my mouth, and use them for thy glory. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're about to do in the hearts of people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. A mother went to wake her son for church one Sunday. When she knocked on his door, he said, "I'm not going." "Why not?" asked the mother. "I'll give you two good reasons," he said. "One, they don't like me. Two, I don't like them." His mother replied, "I'll give you two good reasons why you will go to church. One, you're 47 years old. Two, you're the pastor." An atheist scientist came to God and said, "We figured out how to make a man without you." God said, "Okay, let me see you do it." So the atheist bent down to the ground and scooped up a handful. But God stopped him and said, "Oh, no, you don't get that. That's my dirt." You know, people are always trying to find reasons why they shouldn't do what they do. When we look at the passage tonight and we look at this, we're looking at the word liberty. And someone says, "Well, what does that have to do with anything?" Well, as I began to study this and began to look at this, I found that there were some interesting things in these three verses. First of all, if we look at this, and I just want to give you a little background of this, if I got this thing right. Yeah, Galatians 5:13. I want you to notice something here. This is broken up, and we look at chapter 5 through chapter 6. This is pretty much the outline. The believer's great law of life and love, chapter 5, verses 13 to 15. And then the walk combating the great enemy in life, that's the lust of the flesh, found in chapter 5, verses 16 to 21. And then the walk bearing God's nature, that's the fruit of the Spirit, chapter 5, verses 22 to 26. And then a walk restoring the man who slips, chapter 6, verses 1 to 5. And then a walk doing good to one's teacher, chapter 6, verses 6 to 10. And then a walk boasting in the cross of Christ, chapter 6, verses 11 to 18. These two chapters are dealing with the walk of a believer. If you're here tonight and you're a believer, we're going to be talking about the walk. The walk that you should walk, the walk that I should walk, and how we should walk. Where we go? Backwards? No. I pushed the arrow. I don't know. Anyway, let's move ahead. We'll move ahead. It's supposed to be working. The believer no longer has to work in order to secure God's approval or his acceptance. The believer is accepted by God through the work of Jesus Christ. However, this is a critical fact that must always be remembered. Christian liberty is not a license that we can sin. Christian liberty is not a license we can sin. So many people take the security of the believer and think they can do anything that they want to do, but they can't. God forgives us, and we are at liberty, but we're not at liberty to sin. Not at all. Christian liberty is being free not to sin. That's what Christian liberty is. It's being free not to sin. Let's see if we can pick it up here. Thank you. Okay, we'll get to this point. Okay? Christian liberty is being free not to sin. It is being free to overcome the passions and urges of the flesh. It's being free to get away from fleshly desires. It wages war against the judgment of man. The believer is a person who is so conscious of the indwelling Holy Spirit and his power that he is able to purge himself and love his neighbor as himself. The believer is so in love with God that he has one desire, and that's to love people. The point is this. Believers do not walk in sin, for he loves God, and he loves his neighbor. The believer walks and lives under the greatest of laws, the law of love. Love is the guiding law of the believer's life. Love, to love one another. I'm going to share with you basically tonight four, let me go back here. Well, it's not there. I don't know where it's at. I'm going to share with you 4 points. Verse number 13, liberty versus license. Verse number 14, love is serving others. And verse number 14, love is not offending, but caring for one's neighbor. And love is not biting and devouring one another. Love is not biting and devouring one another. One of the things that I've seen in so many Christians is that they get saved, but it seems like they still carry on that way that they used to live. And they still talk the same way, but they just don't use the verbal language that's wicked. Do you understand what I'm saying? In other words, they learn how to do it in another way that bites and gets to you. You see, liberty versus license. Let's see if we can pick it up here. This thing is not working. Liberty versus license. Liberty versus faith. There's liberty in that we have the ability to do what God wants us to do when we study the Scriptures. Look at verse number 13 with me there. Notice what it says. It says, "For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty, only," it says, "use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another." Notice the latter part of the verse, which is so important. We, by love, we are to serve one another. As a church, what is our responsibility? I teach all of our pastors that it's important for them to love their community. If you go to a community and all of our national pastors, if you don't love your community, you're not going to reach your community. If you don't love the people in your community, you're not going to reach them. If you don't love your neighbor, you're not going to reach your neighbor. I ask people all the time, when's the last time that you talked to your neighbor? The other day I was out and my neighbor came out and I had an opportunity to talk with him. And he was sharing with me some problems that he was going through. And I said, well, you know, I said, it's interesting. I said, you know, I do a lot of, I have a counseling degree. And I said, you know, I do a little counseling in that area. And he said, well, would you counsel me right now? And I said, first of all, tell me something. What's your relationship with God? What's your relationship? What's your walk with God? Because you see, if you want to do it, if you want to do it God's way, that's one way. If you want to do it the world's way, you do it the world's way. But God's way is much better than the world's way. See, God gives us regulations and rules on how to rule our life. Liberty. And then God loves us enough. God cares about us. By love, we serve one another. A person who loves does not act like a lord over people. We don't lord over people. We love people. We have to have empathy. We have to understand. We serve as helps, a helper. I tell folks, I'm just a helper. If I can help somebody, I want to help somebody. And I think as a believer, that's what we're supposed to do. If you see someone in need, the Scripture says, if you see someone in need, what do? Pass by them? Or do you help them? That's a missionary. A missionary goes into another country as a guest. I'm a guest in that country. I'm not from that. I'm a guest there. So I have to understand those people. I have to study those people. I have to learn the culture. I have to be able to adapt to them. I have to be able to realize that they have their ways, and I've got to show them God's way so that God can change them. There's a cultural difference. We have to have a spirit of help. Now, some people don't want help. Some people don't think they need any help. But I'll be honest with you, all of us need a little help. Amen? If we're honest with ourselves, we all can use a little help. Notice something else here, that it shows kindness and gentleness. That's what love does. That's what it's talking about here in the Scripture, love versus license. It's talking about, I'm not licensed, I'm not going around, I have to do this. I'm doing it because I love God. Do you do what you do because you love God? Or you do it because you have to? It's the right thing to do. It's the Baptist way. No. It's God's way. It's God's way. It has nothing to do with being the Baptist way. It has everything to do with God. I do what I do because God allows me to do it. He helps me do it. He shows me the way. I don't know what to do. And sometimes I really am out there, and I just don't know what to do. You've been out there, George, sometimes, you know, you just don't know what to do. You know, even us older preachers, we sometimes don't admit it, but sometimes we really don't know what we're doing. We really don't. We think, we try to show everybody we know what we're doing, but a lot of times we're kind of just operating on the basis of just, wow, I hope I get by with this. I hope I do this. We're all out there on the limb. We need to help. We need God's help. And you see, when the church, listen to me, when the church comes together and realizes that they need one another, that's what the scripture talks about, one arm, one hand, one foot. We're all one in the body of Christ. When we all need one another, that's the problem that we have in America today, is we've lost the desire to help and do for others, not just in giving them money, but helping them get from one point to the next point. I wrote an article the other day, and I said, the problem is that in most of the communities is that we've lost our way when it comes to teaching people the right way. I told my grandson tonight, I said, you're going to go to church tonight? And he said, you know, I'm trying to get, he wants to travel with us. He wants to go with us. And so I said to him, I said, oh, man, that's wonderful. You know, I love to have my grandson with me. I said, I'm going to buy you a suit. Suit? You don't even know what a suit is? I mean, these kids today, most of them don't even know what a suit is. Amen? They don't know what it means to dress. They just go anywhere they want to go. But I want to fix him up and put a tie on him and make him look good. And then I want to teach him what Jesus can do for him and how that Jesus can help him. You see, this license, and then I want you to notice something else. Look at this with me. Well, you see, it expresses concern and care. That's what this love does. It expresses concern. We're not licensed. We have a love. We're really concerned. I think you saw in Guatemala, I have compassion for Guatemala. I have compassion for the people. I really do. I have compassion for the people in Haiti. I have compassion for the people in the Ukraine. I have compassion for the people in Vietnam. Because when I go there, I'm so thankful for what God has done for me and how good he's been to me that I just want to help them. You see, it demonstrates sympathy and empathy. It demonstrates sympathy and empathy. You know what empathy is? Empathy is putting yourself in the other person's shoes. That's what empathy is. When I go to the Philippines, I love the Filipino people. I just love them. I can't. I mean, they're so sweet. And when I get off the airplane, they come running to me, the preacher boys, and they say, Preacher Dave, let me take your Bible. Preacher Dave, let me carry this. Preacher Dave. And then I'll go someplace and they're bringing a Coca-Cola, Diet Coca-Cola to me, and they're bringing a drink to me. Preacher Dave, you need this. You're sweating awful hard. You got a drink. You got a drink. Preacher Dave. They care. They care. And you know what? What's so interesting, during the great storm that took place about three years ago, we were there in Cebu when that storm came in, 200 and some miles an hour, went up in that lady. I watched those people as they pulled together. They started caring for one another. They started pulling all their stuff that they had together. Whatever they could get, they were taking it and put it on trucks and put it on things and sending it up to Lady. And let me tell you something. You didn't hear one complaint. You didn't hear one complaint. They were helping one another. They were doing something. I thought that was wonderful. Today, what you hear, thank God for the first two storms that went through. Trump did a pretty good job, but now the media's out there for Puerto Rico. No matter what they do. See, that's the problem in America. We forgot who we really are. We forgot what God has done for us. We forgot that we're a people of God and that we're to love and help and care and realize that God has blessed us as a nation. We have it good. You see, love is serving others. And then love is never withdraws from another's person's feelings that he or she feels. You don't withdraw because a person feels the way that they feel. Sometimes you just have to listen to them. Amen? Sometimes, you know, listen, guys, sometimes the wife, she may not feel good, and you're so busy about doing what you need to do, and she just wants to talk to you. She just wants your attention for just a minute. Amen? Come on, ladies, help me out here. She just wants your attention for a little bit. And you're busy. You got things to go. And she says, listen, when you get sick, I'm always there for you, you big baby. Yeah. Amen?
I'm not here. Oh, man, I'm hurting, honey. I need this. And, oh, God, bring me a drink. And she goes in the other room, and she brings you the drink. And, oh, thank you, darling. But when she gets sick, get up, woman, man. What's the matter with you? How about it, ladies? You ought to be on my side here. I'm helping you tonight. It's the truth. We don't understand. We don't have empathy. We don't feel for other people. Did you ever feel for someone else? Did you ever really, I mean, think about it. What if that was me? What if that was me? Pastor was telling me about Martha and what she's been through. My wife and I, we got in the car and said, oh, God, bless their hearts. My goodness. I could feel how what it must have been. I thought for Pastor. I thought for the church. All the struggle. You see, we have to understand there's a hurting people out there. And we have to love them. Maybe we got it good today, but tomorrow we may not have it so good. Tomorrow we may wake up and it's not as well. We have to love. See, that's what this is all about, this liberty that we have. This liberty is we can love with no limitation. And we don't have to do what the world does. We don't have to go the way of the world. We're not in the world anymore. The night I got saved, I left the world. I didn't have any problem. I didn't even know I was supposed to leave the world. No one told me I was supposed to leave the world. No one told me to quit drinking. No one told me to quit the bar room. No one. I just, something inside of me said, you don't need to go there anymore. And after a while, my pastor said to me, he said, boy, he said, you should. I said, he said, what told you? Who told you? Where'd you hear that? I said, I don't know. I just did what God said. Let me show you something else. It does not deserve the efforts or help. You see, it is not worth the effort or help. It's not worth. It is. You see, we're supposed to. This is what people think. Is there, it says, is less than what he or should be, we should be? Is it less than what we should be? Is it less than that? No, it's not. You see, there's this danger in this life. Romans chapter 6, verse 16 says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey his servant, ye are whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness? Hebrews 5:9 says, and being made perfect, became an author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. God loves us. God loves us. Why does he love us? Because he came and died on the cross for us. And greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. We are supposed to be like little Christ walking around loving other people. That doesn't mean we don't take a stand. That doesn't mean that we don't stand for what's right. That doesn't mean that we don't stand up and say that's wrong. What it says is that we love no matter what. We love no matter what. You know, I was very unlovable before I became a Christian. My wife will tell you there are sometimes I'm not that lovable today. I mean, really. I mean, there are times that we're not. How about it? Amen? Do I hear an amen? There are times that we're not so lovable. There are times that we're not who we're supposed to be. But thank God that we have someone that loves us. Thank God we have a person that loves us. You know, marriage, and I can say this after almost 47 years, marriage is forgiving. Did you know that? It's forgiving. It's not seeing the person through your eyes. It's seeing the person through God's eyes. When you see the person through God's eyes, you can't help. If my wife looked at me for who I really was, I'd really be in trouble. Thank God she looks through God to me. Amen? Because the reality is this, is that we see, and people ask me, how do you stay married for so long? Let me tell you how. You look at one another through God. And you look beyond the faults. You see beyond the failures. You see beyond all those little things. Because, you know, listen, guys. Hey, some of you young guys, let me tell you something. Right now you got a really kind of tight, maybe little abs and a little tough body, you know. And man, you stand in the mirror and your wife says, look at that hunk, you know. Let me tell you something. When you get older, it doesn't look that way. Next thing you know, it starts to drop here and drop there and drop over here and drop there. And your wife looks and she says, what happened to that hunk? The reality is it's gone. And then she looks in the mirror and she said, but I don't look like I used to. My face, look at here. I got wrinkles here. Oh, me, I got this and I got that. Hey, it's all part of the old aging stage. Amen? But you know, like I tell my wife, to me, she's just as beautiful as she's always been. I see her the same way I saw her the first time, and I went, wow. No wonder I went to church. I was following her. You see, the reality is that love looks beyond those things. That's what love does. And loving one another is so important. Loving thy neighbor and caring. Notice something else. It is to derelict, immoral, and uneducated, and unrecognized below others. You see, love never withdraws from any another person's feelings that he or she does not deserve the effort of love, is not worth the effort to help, is less than what we should be, or is too derelict, immoral, uneducated, unrecognized, or below others. Love is not offending, but caring for one's neighbor, caring as much as one cares for oneself. It must be admitted. Love involves some very practical acts that are clearly spelled out in Scripture. I go to 1 Corinthians 13, and you can see love. We're just going to look at those. Love suffereth long. It endures long. It's patient. You know, some people need a little bit more time than others. Amen? As a pastor, I found that out. I remember I had a man in my church. This man was an alcoholic, a drunk. I mean, he was bad. He was really, really bad. And his wife came to church, and she got saved. Their children got saved. And she told me, she said, you need to pray for me because he gets drunk and he comes home and beats me. And I said, oh, wow. So anyway, one night I said, you call me when this happens. So one night she calls us up on the phone. She said, Pastor, you need to come because he's going to beat me. So I call one of my deacons. And I said, Deke, you need to come Deke tonight. He said, Deke, what? I said, you're going to go to somebody's house tonight. A man's beating up his wife. He said, oh, preacher, what are you going to do? I said, well, wait till we get there. And we got over there, and here's this little short little guy, little tiny little fella, and he's standing there and he's smiling all over, and he didn't blacken his wife's eyes. I mean, he blackened them, and he's over there, he's smiling, saying, look what I did. And I don't know, the Holy Spirit or something got a hold of me. I don't know what it was, and I reached over and I grabbed him by his collar and I pulled him clear up out of the seat, and I put his face right in my face. I said, if you ever touch her again, I'll come back here and beat the dickens out of you. And the deacon turned around and said, Pastor. I said, I don't know. It was just the Holy Spirit came over me. I don't know what it was. Anyway, I put him back down in the seat, and I left. And I guess a few weeks went by, and she called one night. She said, Pastor, he's threatening to beat me again. So I called the same deacon. Oh, my. I said, Deke, we need to go Deke tonight. He said, what are we going to do? I said, we're going back over to Joe's house, and we're going to go see him. Oh, Pastor, you're not going to do what you did the last time, are you? No, I said, I might do something different this time. I don't know. Anyway, we got over there, and he was waiting inside. He hadn't touched her. And when I walked through the door, he said, you know something, preacher? I just wanted to see if you'd come back. I came back. You know, he came to church, and he got saved. He really got saved. But he was one of these guys that needed a lot of maintenance. He was one of these guys that you had to always be around for. You know what I mean? He'd come in and he'd be sad. And I finally put him to work in the church because he couldn't hold a job anyplace. And I put him as a custodial guy in there because we had a Christian school and we needed help and all that stuff. So I put him to work. He'd come in and we'd have devotions and pray, and he did really good. He did fantastic for about 4 or 5 months. And one night, Elsie called me and she said, Pastor, I cannot find him anywhere. I think he's gone off the wagon and drinking. I said, oh, my. So I called the deacon. I said, Deke, we need to go Deke tonight. This guy had led to Christ, and he and I had a lot of fun together. And so he went along with me. We went around town. This was in South Bend, Indiana. And we were looking for the bar room that he was at. We looked for his car. We found this car parked out in front of this bar room. And the deacon said to me, he said, hey, what are you going to do, preacher? I said, well, we're going to go in there and get him. He said, what? I said, we're going to go in there and get him. I said, isn't that what the Bible says? If one go astray, go and get him. Isn't that what it says? Does it say that? Am I right? Somebody say amen. I said, we're going to go in there and get him. He said, preacher, we're not supposed to go. I said, we're not going in there to drink. We're going in to get one of our men had gone astray. So I went through the door. I had to go in and go inside. I walked through and I said, hello, folks. I'm Pastor Dave Smells from Fellowship Baptist Church, and I'm looking for one of my men. Oh, there he is, right over there. And I went over and sat down beside him, and I said, come on, let's go. He looked at me, and this guy stood up and said, you leave him alone. I said, sit down and shut up. And I grabbed him and took him out. I took him back, took him home, gave him some coffee, threw him in the shower, got him sobered up. And I'll never forget what he said. Listen to this, folks. This is what he said. He said, Pastor, he said, my granddaddy was a drunk. My daddy was a drunk. I'm a drunk. And no one has ever loved me or cared for me like you have. No one has ever taken the time. Let me tell you something. That man came to church and he served God. He served God. I never had any more problem with him. Never. When it came time to leave the church, I was going someplace else. And I told the new pastor, I said, Pastor, there's you have a man in this church that needs some extra help. You're going to have to cater to him. You're going to have to be around for him because he's just one of those kind of guys that needs a little help. He said, oh, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. Evangelistically speaking. I left. 6 months later, the man got drunk and hung himself in the jail. Why? Because he was neglected. He was neglected. There are some people that need a little bit more than others. There's some people. You know, if you look at Scripture, there was a man in the Bible that needed a little extra help. How many of you know who it was? He stuck his foot in his mouth a lot. Said a lot of things he shouldn't say. But he ended up being one of the greatest preachers. His name was Peter. He needed a little extra help. Jesus gave him a little extra help. You see, my friends, let me tell you something. Love is kind. Love envies not. It's not jealous. Love vaunteth not itself. It does not brag or does not boast. I like your pastor. I'm not afraid to say it. I like your pastor. I really do. I think he is what he is. And he's straightforward. And I like that in a man. I don't have to worry about where he is or what he thinks. I think the way he thinks a little bit sometimes, maybe a little bit. I like that. You should like that and love that because there's so many men that don't do that. He loves. He cares. Love vaunts not itself. It does not brag. It does not boast. Whatever God does, he does it. It does it because he loves us. It's not because we do anything. It's not because we've done anything. He's done it all. Love is not puffed up, vainglorious, arrogant, prideful. We have to be careful of those things. We can get awful prideful. We can think that we're better than somebody else. We can think that when we look at somebody walking down the street that maybe is not up to par, we say, oh, look at them. You ever think about it? You could be there. When I go overseas and see all those kids walking around and begging for food and I see families doing that, I think, you know, dear God, I could have been born there. I could have been born there. Have you ever taken the time? Look at me, every one of you. I'm going to finish. Have you ever taken the time to sit down with somebody from another country who has lived in a different environment and let them tell you about their life? It will change your life if you'll listen to them. I have a daughter-in-law who was born in Ukraine, who grew up under the Soviet Union. And to hear her mother and to hear her father and her grandparents to talk about what they went through, I am so glad I was born in. I am so glad. To hear, I've been in the Philippines up in the top where you go up where the pillboxes are at, where the Japanese come in. I've sat down with some of the Filipino people who are older and they told me what the Japanese did and how they came in and they raped the women and they slaughtered and all of this stuff. And they said, "All, listen to me, folks, listen to me." They said, all we wanted to do is have freedom. And one of them said, MacArthur said, I'm coming back, I'm coming back. And when he came back, and then they said, well, you know what else happened, preacher? What happened? He said, America sent the missionaries, and the missionaries brought in Jesus, and we learned about Jesus, and now we got Jesus. Love, folks. That's real love. Love does not behave itself unseemly, unbecoming, rudely, indecently, unmannerly. Looks beyond. Love seeks not her own. It is not selfish or self-seeking. Does not insist on its own right of way. My way or the highway. That's the problem today. There's only God's way. It's not my way. When I went in the military, I never forget what the sergeant said. How many were in the military? Anybody here? Hey, when I went in, the sergeant said to me, he said, I'll never forget it. I got on the bus out of Miami because I was only 17 years old. And when I went in, I got on the bus, and he was real nice when I got on the bus. And he said, we're going out to base. We're going to Tank Hill, South Carolina. And so we pulled in through the gates, and we pulled up to this area, and all of a sudden, this big, tall dude stood up with his big hat on. He turned around. His whole face and expression changed, and boy, the language that came out of him was not nice, and what he had to say to me was not nice, and he made me feel about that big. He said, there's your way, there's my way, and there's the Army way, and guess what we're going to do? We're going to do it the Army way. I didn't like that. But it wasn't long that I had to do that because I knew if I didn't, what was coming my way. They had a way of getting us where we needed to be. That's the problem today. We got too many young people that have no leadership. They have no guidance. We ought to start the draft back up. You may disagree with that, but I think it would really help. Love is not easily provoked, not touchy, angry, or fretful, or resentful. We shouldn't resent what other people have or how God is blessing someone else. Thank God God is blessing someone. Isn't it wonderful to see how God's doing? Isn't it wonderful to watch God? We should be so happy when we hear great testimonies about what God is doing. We should be up. Praise God. Hallelujah. The church has lost that, folks. There's no excitement in the church today. People say, well, I'm just enduring. Love thinks no evil. It harbors and plans no evil. Thought takes no account of wrong done. Love rejoices in not iniquity, wrong and sin and evil and injustice, but rejoices in the truth, justice and righteousness. We need to stand firm on what we believe. Love bears all things. Sometimes it's tough. Sometimes it's really tough. Love believes all things. It exercises faith in everything. Is ready to believe the best in anyone and everyone. Hey, I always saw this one. I had this one kid in the church, and he was always in trouble. And they'd bring him to my office. He was in a school. They'd bring him to my office. And I'd always say to him every time that I talked to him, I know you can do better. I know you can do better. I know you can do better. He looked at me one day and he said, preacher, you're always telling me I can do better. How come I don't do better? I said, because you're not listening to that little voice that's inside of you that says, don't do it. Don't do it. If you start listening, you'll start do better. A couple weeks went by and he came into my office. This time he didn't come because someone brought him. He came on his own. He said, you know what? There is a little voice that talks to me. Love hopes all things. It keeps us hope in everything and under all circumstances. Love endures all things without weakening. It gives power to endure. Love is not biting and devouring one another. That's verse number 16. It doesn't snap. It doesn't condemn. It doesn't expose. It doesn't hurt. It doesn't criticize. It doesn't accuse. It doesn't misuse. It doesn't slander. It doesn't censor. It doesn't covet. It doesn't abuse and gossip, exploit and take. Love doesn't do that. Love looks beyond those things. That's what real love is. And if we can understand that and understand that this liberty that we have, that the scripture talks about, it's not a license to do wrong. It's not a license to live the way we want to live. It's not that. It is a command for us to love one another in Christ. That's what that liberty is. We have a liberty that we can go beyond the norm and we can love when people aren't loved by anyone else. That's how you reach people. That's how you do it. I had a church in Virginia, my first church, and we were reaching a lot of people in the community. It was a small community, rural community. And so we started reaching people, and we were really actually running out of people to reach because we had knocked on every door. And so I got this thought one day. How many remember Curtis Hudson? Curtis Hudson was preaching in a meeting, and Curtis said, he talked about what he did at his church. He said he got a gas can and went out and looked for people that were run out of gas, and he would lead them to Christ and then invite them to church. Well, I thought about doing that, so I went and got a gas can and looked for people, and I didn't find people running out of gas. I found people drunk on the side of the road. So I started reaching all the drunks. And there was a lot of them in the country community. I didn't realize there was many of them. I started leading to Christ, and before long, Open Door Baptist Church was called the Drunk Church because we had a lot of drunks in it. We went out and reached them. We cared about them. We cared about the community. Let me tell you something. Folks, there's a lot of people out there that need the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you can't give up on them. You have to reach them. And just because they're in sin and just because they smell bad doesn't mean that they can't be reached. One night I was preaching in Massachusetts, and I was preaching a service on Thursday night. And in the middle of the service, this man comes in through the back door. By the way, this was a Presbyterian church. They asked me to come present the gospel of Jesus Christ. The pastor said he needed some fire there. I told him I'd bring it there. I was a young preacher at the time. And so this man come in the back of the church, and he sat down, and he sat right next to the pastor's wife. And I'll never forget, she said, "Oh my, he stinketh. Oh, he stinketh." And I said, "Don't worry, he'll be okay." He sat back there, and I preached. At the end, when the invitation was given, guess what happened? He came walking down. Listen to me, folks. He wasn't drunk when he walked down. He came down, and that man gloriously got saved. He gloriously got saved. When he left the church, I watched him go up one of the side streets there in Waltham, Massachusetts. He jumped up the air, and he kicked his feet together, and he said, "I got what I came for. I got what I came for. I got what I came for." See, if you get it, you're going to know you got it. I know the night I got it. I got it. I didn't doubt it. I got it. It changed me. If you get it, it'll change you. It'll change your whole life. It'll change your disposition. It'll change your attitude. It'll change your relationship with others. It'll change your walk. It'll change your talk. It'll change everything. And you know, if you really, really get it, others will see that you got it. Because it's just something about it. One lady said to me one time, she said, "I think it's just the glow. I don't know if it's the glow. All I know is that you can tell." The Bible says the Spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we're the children of God. Tonight, are you at liberty? Are you really free? Are you free from the bondage of sin? Are you really free? Or does sin still got a hold of you? Are you battling with it? Are you battling with whether or not, why do I do what I do? See, the answer is this. You can do what God wants you to do if you submit yourself to God to let Him do it through you. You have to submit yourself. You have to say, "Lord, I give it all." Several years ago, I was in a revival service. This is back many years ago when I was in Bible college. And the preacher came for revival, and he said, "I'm going to offer to all the preacher boys tonight, if they want to come up, I've got something very special for them." And he said, "If you'd like to get what I've got as special, come up after service." I was one of those guys, always so hungry for anything I could get. I was just hungry. I wanted as much as I could get. And after service, me and two or three other preachers, young preacher boys, went forward. And he said, "How many of you have really asked God what He thinks about you?" Ooh. He said, "This is what I want you to do." He said, "I want you to come to the altar tonight." And he said, "I plan on spending a lot of time. And I want you to ask God this question. What does God think of you? What does He think of you?" Man, we prayed. I mean, sweat was rolling off of us. And we were praying and praying and praying. Ask God, what do you think of us, God? And finally, I don't know, the Spirit of God said to me, "Why don't you just answer the question, what does He think of you? You died when you got saved. He's not supposed to see you. He's supposed to see Jesus. I raised my hand and I said to the preacher, I said, "Preacher, I don't think God sees anything in me. I think he only sees maybe Christ that's in me. That's what he's supposed to see. Because I'm supposed to die. I'm supposed to die to self. And I'm supposed to let Jesus Christ rule and reign in my life." Let me ask you tonight, is he ruling and reigning in your life? Is he the number one? Or is he two, three, four, five down the line? If he's number one, your life will be changed. If he's not number one and you do what's right, you'll see a change. Matter of fact, you'll turn around and say, "Wow, I didn't know this could happen. I didn't know this is real." Tonight, I'm going to ask Pastor come, take the invitation. Tonight, I asked you, has God spoken to you? I know, I don't know what time it is. I could not even begin to tell you what time it is. I've probably gone over time, probably kept most of you gone to sleep, and you're waiting to get home. I'm sorry if I did. No, I'm not. All I can tell you is I love you, and I hope tonight God has helped you through his word. Pastor, why don't you come?